Hello. Welcome to the Gardena Valley Japanese Cultural Institute Day of Remembrance 2022. My name is Alvin Takamori, and I'm a volunteer with the GVJCI Day of Remembrance Planning Committee, and I'm also a board member. On behalf of the GVJCI, I want to thank the George and Sakai Aratani Community Advancement Research Endowment and the UCLA Asian American Studies Center for co-sponsoring this event. Also, I want to thank Dr. Donald Inodomi for his steadfast support of this program and all of the organizations that have agreed to be community supporters for this DOR. Also, thanks to all of you for joining us today. Once again, because of health and safety concerns, we are presenting an online program. And although I would very much prefer to meet all of you in person, this does have some benefits. It allows us to present a great deal of additional in-depth information on our website that we can't possibly cover in 2 hours. So if you haven't seen it yet, we encourage you to go to our website and look at all of that. Another benefit of being online is, of course, that you can enjoy this program from the comfort of your home. Now, later in this program, we're going to have a question and answer session. So if you do have a question, don't put it in the chat box, put it in the Q&A section. Now, about a week ago, well, it was a week ago, on February 19th, we marked the 80th anniversary of President Franklin Roosevelt's signing of Executive Order 9066, which enabled the imprisonment of over 120,000 people of Japanese ancestry. Now the 120,000, I mean, it's as horrible as that sounds, it's really just a statistic. And to fully appreciate and connect to the experience of the people who were incarcerated, we need to delve into their lives as individuals, and that's not easy. The experience was very negative, and a lot of people didn't want to talk about it afterwards. And of course, after 80 years, a lot of them are no longer with us to tell us about it. However, we can gain some insight through the arts. The artwork that people sketched, painted, sculpted, wrote, and performed revealed things about their lives. A painting of people standing in long lines tells a story. Building furniture out of scrap wood because you didn't have any furniture says something. Maintaining traditional Japanese arts in the face of anti-Japanese sentiment makes a statement. So the theme for our Day of Remembrance program, Camp Creativity, Resilience Through Art, delves into this aspect of the incarcerees' lives. To help us, we are joined by Shirley Muramoto Wong, an accomplished koto player who earned her Daishihan master's degree from the Chikushi School in Fukuoka. She also founded the Murasaki Ensemble, a chamber jazz group, and she has conducted extensive research into traditional music, dance, and drama in the camps, which she compiled in the documentary Hidden Legacy, Japanese Traditional Performing Arts in the World War II Internment Camps. We're also privileged to have Amy Uyeki, an artist who works in multiple mediums. She illustrated The Extraordinary Voyage of Kamone by Lori Dengler and Amya Miller. And her woodcut prints and drawings are the basis of the animation in Searchlight Serenade, a documentary film that tells the story of the big bands in the camps. But first, our keynote speaker, Delphine Hirasuna. She's a writer who has spent many years as a journalist and has written numerous articles and books on design and design education. Notably for our purposes, she wrote The Art of Gaman, Arts and Crafts from the Japanese American Internment Camps, 1942 to 1946, and the book that you're seeing on your screen, All That Remains, the legacy of the World War II Japanese American internment camps. The former book, The Art of Gaman, evolved into an exhibition that she had curated. And it's been shown in multiple museums, including the Smithsonian American Art Museum, Renwick Gallery, and did a 5-city tour in Japan. And so with that, I am going to turn the program over to Delphine.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for inviting me. And I'm really pleased to see that you're tackling the subject of creativity in the camps, because I think that sort of is really a sign of the resilience and resourcefulness of the Japanese who were there. I'm going to rush this along a little because this talk was intended to be a little bit longer. It all started, of course, with Pearl Harbor. Next slide, please. And the day of Pearl Harbor, the FBIs came in and started searching through people's houses. By the end of the day, they had arrested a lot of community leaders, ministers, and people were scared. And because the agents who came to search their house didn't know how to read Japanese, people start throwing things in a well, burning it. My grandmother had to throw away all her books and records, and it was very traumatic for them. But this is a picture of one of the agents searching home. Next slide, please. Of course, at that time, the Japanese, Imperial Japan, was winning the battle. And so there was a great deal of fear in the US that there would be an attack on the Pacific coast. Next slide, please. And because there was so much anti-Japanese prejudice, that this person in Oakland put up a sign saying, I am American. The Chinese were going around wearing pins saying, I am Chinese and not Japanese. And but that was there was a great deal of fear that the first weeks after the bombing of Pearl Harbor. Next slide. At that point, Roosevelt signed the executive order 9066 on February 19th, 1941. And at that time, he authorized that any person that the military deemed necessary to exclude from an area, he authorized that to be made possible. As it turned out, everybody who lived on the West Coast, every Japanese who lived on the West Coast, and at that time, that was 120. According to the 1940 census, there were 127,000 Japanese living in the continental U.S. 120,000 of those people lived on the West Coast. So when the order went down to that all the people were going to be moved off the West Coast, that it entailed 90% of all ethnic Japanese living on the continental U.S. The average age in camp was 17. Two-thirds of the people in camp were American citizens. They were born here. The Issei weren't allowed to become citizens. So at that point they were pretty old. They were in their 40s, 50s. And because the US cut off immigration in 1925 from Japan, virtually all of the people have been here at least 20 years. So that they had deep roots in the United States. Next slide, please. This is the way people found out. This is Little Tokyo. And this is the same proclamation printed on a storefront wall. Next slide. There is just, because it said you had 1 week to clear out your, to, you could only take what you could carry. And there was just a mad rush to find a place to store their things. And this was a sale in San Francisco. Next slide. And this is the inside. Next slide. Shortly after that, the people, this is San Pedro Island, and people had to report to be put into camp, and they were only allowed to take what they could carry. And I have, when I see this picture, I'm always shocked, because 1 minute you're just an average citizen, and the next minute you're treated like you're really dangerous, and there are these guards standing over you. Next slide. This is a map of the camps. There were assembly centers, which were in the neighborhoods where you lived. And then there were the permanent camps, the relocation camps or concentration camps. There were 10 of them. 8 of them were in the desert, and 2 of them were in Arkansas, which was sort of a swampy area. Next slide. But what I didn't realize when I started researching this subject is that the order to evacuate covered everybody. They said not one drop of Japanese blood on the West Coast. So old people, young people, next slide. Blind people, next slide. This man had Parkinson's, next slide. They took people out of hospitals. If you were in a hospital, you had to, and if you couldn't walk, you were placed on a pallet and taken to the train. Next slide. And this is what really surprised me. The order came down, an orphanage said, what is your rule on orphans and foster care people? And they heard back, not one drop of Japanese blood on the West Coast. So most of the large number of orphans in the camps were not full-blooded Japanese, because mixed marriage just weren't allowed at the time. Some of these children didn't even know they were Japanese until they were rounded up and put in camp. The youngest orphan in camp was 3 months old. So here it really begs the question, how are these people such a danger to the Western defense? What did a 3 month old orphan, what could that person do? And as you could see from this picture, many of these kids do not look full-blooded Japanese. The orphans were all segregated into what was called the children's village in Manzanar. Excellent. Because the camps weren't built yet, they had assembly centers up and down the West Coast, and most of them were on fairgrounds and on racetracks. And this is Tan Phran. People were assigned to live in horse stalls. And they had mattress ticking, and they were told to go to a pile of hay and fill their mattress with hay. Next slide. This is another picture of Tan Phran. Already you could see that they were trying to beautify it by putting up curtains in the horse stall. Next slide. And here they really went to town, put up curtains and planted a little victory garden. And so this was the first few months after they were put in camp. They were told that the assembly center was only going to be for a short time until the permanent camps were built. But the permanent camps, they hadn't started on it yet. And one thing is that the camps, they the urban areas didn't want these concentration camps in their neighborhood. So they had to find areas, remote areas. So eight of the camps, here we go, next slide. Eight of the camps were in the desert, and two were in, the two in Arkansas were in swampland. And before they could build the camps, they often had to build the roads to get to the camp. And so it was much more time consuming than they thought it was going to be. And so people who went into the, were living in the horse stall and thought they would, it'll only be a week or two, it often turned into months. Next slide. They were trying to build the camps and fast, but they couldn't, they had raw lumber that they were working with, and it was there was this big panic to get these built. So they asked for some of the internees to volunteer to help build the camps. I know some of my uncles volunteered to go, and they one of the reasons they volunteered was they figured it would be, they could get out of the horse stall faster and get into what was seemed like housing. So that was another, next slide. And this is Manzanar. And Manzanar, like most of the other desert camps, was very wind, they had horrible sandstorms. The temperatures would go over, you know, were often over 100 during the day. Poston, it got, the temperatures went up to 125. They had recorded temperatures of 125, which is, so this is the condition that people found themselves in. Go to the next slide, please. And with guard towers everywhere guarding them, they could, and okay, good. Next slide. And in this, when they got there, they, you know, these, they sort of set up, started trying to create a community, a little one square mile community. And they had schools, and they had all these recreation, and you know, what's really admirable about the camps was, or the Japanese, was that they weren't going to just sit there and give up. It was really, and one of the big things that they did, next slide, they had toy exchanges. Next slide. They had, this is a nursery school where someone built a barrack thing that they could play with. Next slide. And they put on all kinds of talent shows. And I'm sure this is all amateur talent, but one of the ways they entertained themselves was talent shows and putting on, you know, forming big bands and musical things and sports. Next slide. And then they also had found when they got to the camps that there was no furniture. There was a bed and a pot-bellied stove and nothing else. So they went about trying to build themselves. Somebody showed me the clothes hangers they made, and they start making chest of drawers. They made a table, they made a chair to sit on. And the good thing about the haste in which they built the camps is they had a lot of scrap lumber. They had piles of it. So people would go sneak onto the scrap pile and steal, take wood so that they could build things. And next slide, please. And they also set up ways to entertain themselves and also with things like art classes. There was a professor from UC Berkeley, Chiro Wata, whose work is in the De Young and other museums. And he had gone to the authorities even before the camps were officially open, saying, you know, if people are taken out of their environment and put in an area of 1 square mile and they aren't allowed anything to do, that it's going to cause unrest. And, you know, let me set up an art school. So he had asked them if he could organize art classes. So even before people left the assembly center, he had started art classes and everything from drawing to fashion design to just paintings. And other groups started things like poetry classes, poetry groups. I was amazed that there are so many Japanese farmers and gardeners who were very active in poetry groups. And so this, even though this was a very tragic situation where these people had lost everything because they couldn't go into camp with anything except what they could carry, what they found was they had time on their hands and they set about exploring, you know, some interest of theirs that they probably would never have done. So, and they didn't consider them, they, you know, most of the people I talked to said it was just busy work. I didn't have, you know, I didn't think of myself as having talent. It was just busy work as was a way to pass the time. And, but what was amazing, next slide. And this was crocheting. And it was that everybody had to find some way to occupy their time. The barrack room wasn't big enough to really sit in. They had no place to go. So having little groups where they crocheted or, next slide, please. Or they painted, or they made pins. Next slide. And so at first it started out as a necessity. Next. This is one of the early chairs. The other thing is people couldn't take cameras or radios or anything into camp at first. Later, they relaxed the rules. So this is Tanforan, and someone, they had record night. So they had audiences just like they're going to a theater, except they're sitting in front of a record player. But the other thing that's interesting about this is that the way, because they didn't have a way to photograph this and bear witness to what they were living through, the people who really did record this were the artists, you know, the sketch artists, the crayons. And so you could see the way we could see what happened in the camps was through seeing all the drawings. And Manny Okubo was somebody who did there are several artists, good and bad, who sketched out their daily life. And that's the thing at that city. And next slide. This is, you know, the men who built the barracks, who volunteered to build the barracks. This is, I think, Heart Mountain. They, when they were finished, the administrator wanted to thank them. And so he asked if somebody would write up a little certificate saying what a great job they did. And what's amazing to me is if you look at the corners, there are guard towers in the corners of this picture. There's cactus at the bottom. There you can see Heart Mountain and barracks at the top. And then it's surrounded by barbed wire. I'm sure they thought they were being terribly artistic and didn't realize the irony of it all. Okay. They also didn't have tools. You couldn't take metal objects in there. So this man found metal in the automotive pool area, and the places had boilers. And so he melted down the metal and made himself scissors. He made himself several pieces. And I've seen a lot of them. It wasn't just this man who made them, but other people tried to make their own tools. Okay. And of course, the showers and the latrine and were all in different rooms. That you know, living units had no bathroom or shower, so people had to walk through unpaved streets to get to them. And so the ghetto was a necessity. There was a whole cottage industry of making slippers so that they can walk to the different places, the laundry room and places, without getting their street shoes dirty. Okay. This was actually crepe paper that was starched and coiled and woven into a basket. There's something, it's really looks very modern to me. So next slide, please. This is a door sign. This is a door sign that you might recognize because it was Jimmy Yamaichi's. And because the barracks all looked alike and people kept walking into each other's spaces, they one of the first things that they did was make a sign to say who lived there. This one was made by Jimmy Yamaichi's family. Okay. This one was made in Heart Mountain, I believe. And it says made in Heart. This is a bilingual braille board. It was made by a man named Mihara. And it was, he was the editor of the Japanese paper in San Francisco. And before he went into camp, he already knew he was going blind. And so when he got there, he started trying to create for himself a braille board, a bilingual braille board. And he got someone to help him build it. And this was so unique that when others found out about it outside of camp, I think it was adopted in some areas. Next slide. This is a chest of drawers, and they were crates, little crates, and then somebody cut the wood crosswise, glued it on, and then shellacked it. So there was just an attempt to be more imaginative and decorative in how they didn't just use a crate, although you did see some furniture that were just crates. Okay. And of course, the shell pins. Tule Lake and Topaz both were over ancient seabeds. And what people found is that even now, when I went to Tule Lake, if you kick the soil at all, the shells would come up of various sizes. And because people died, they had funerals and they had weddings, they didn't have any vegetation there, any flowers. So someone discovered that if you pick up the shells and form them into bouquets and corsages that you could and paint them. So this became a really widespread hobby in two of the camps. And there's some amazing large, amazingly large ones too. But these are some of the corsages that were made. Okay. Yep. Next slide. And then the other thing that happened in camp was they started drafting people or people from the army into the army from the camps. And the tradition in Japan was to send people into, when someone was being sent into harm's way, to make them a sending body, a thousand stitch, mostly sashes with a tiger for who was, I guess the tiger returns home and it's courageous. And the thing about these knots is that each knot had to be tied by a different person. So you were sent off to war with the good wishes of a thousand people. And when people start being drafted out of into the army, all of the camps, there was a lot of sending body being passed around. People put in their one stitch and sent it along. My dad's was done on a rice sack. This was really unusual. This woman put it on, I think it had to be her slip. She cut it up and turned it into a vest. This is the only one of its kind that I've ever seen. Most of them are on rice sacks. Okay, next slide. There was a doll making class, I think in Topaz. And I saw a picture of the all the women who were making dolls. Next slide. And this is the Hanafuda card game. This man, he painted his own deck of cards, and he was so good at it, and people were talking about it, that he started getting orders from everywhere. And he had his own little cottage industry that formed. Okay. This was built by the man, the brothers who built the San Jose Buddhist Church. And they were professional woodworkers before they came to America. When they went into camp, they continued building things. Butsudan, the Buddhist family shrine, people, when they got there, people had felt that to be a good practicing Buddhist, you had to have your own family shrine, and people made it from all kinds of things. Somebody told me that her father made it out of a cigar box. I've seen some made out of hollowed out logs. There are a lot of different materials used. I don't know how many survived, but this one was made by professional woodworkers, and they made it in camp. Okay. This was made by, there was a slate quarry outside of Topaz. And when this man was killed in Topaz, they decided that they could open the gates and let people wander around outside. And what they discovered was there was a slate quarry just outside the gate. And this man, Mr. Isayama, he started carving slate objects, slate teapots. If you saw my book, there pictures of it, teapots, teacups, they're just amazing things. He did trays. And like so many of the people who carved, once he got out of camp, and you couldn't find a job, he became a gardener. But this is what really intrigued me about most of the people who were artists in camp. They never went back to their art form. They had to get a job. They couldn't, employment was hard to find. And so many people said once they got out of camp, they didn't do anything because they didn't have time, and they considered what they were creating in camp busy work. And I look at this and I think this is not busy work. This should be in a museum. In fact, I think I know the Smithsonian called me, about 6 months ago, and they wanted to know if they could get any of this man's carvings. So I think they arranged to have it adopted into their permanent collection. This is made out of papier-mâché, and it's just nice. Okay. And then people were in camp for three and a half, four years. And after they made all the necessary things, the clothes hangers, the chest of drawers, the table, the chair to sit on, they just started carving or doing things for their own recreation. And this is one of them. I've seen two of these. And so I tend to believe there was a little group or a class. And so everybody had the same homework. They made this. Okay. This one is a train that if you look closely at it, it's made out of tin cans, watch parts, bolts. It looks like a file folder, wires. It's really amazing. But what's even more amazing is that rolls on the tracks. He made the tracks and it actually rolls. The other thing is that when he got older, he didn't know what to do with it. So he walked into a museum in Independence near Manzanar, and he just handed it to them. And he handed them a couple of boats that he had built and said, you know, my kids don't want it here, you could have it. But it's really quite an amazing train. Okay. The bird pins. Every camp made bird pins. The good thing about the bird pins is that it took very little wood. It just took the edge of a crate, and there are lots of crates available, and you need it like a 3-inch block of wood. And they took an Audubon book or cards, and they carve birds, and there are thousands of these in existence. The one man who was really exceptional, he had carved like 70 bird pins. So people say, oh, I have a bird pin, and they say, and I think, yeah, a lot of people made bird pins. One woman told me that her father told her to take out the garbage he was cleaning, and she discovered an entire box of bird pins. And when she asked her father about it, he said, oh, throw it away, it's just junk, I made it in camp. So this is heartbreaking what, you know, people threw away. This is a milk bottle cap with sunflower seeds glued onto it with the shells in the center. This was the guy who, if you remember the scissors, this guy carved this cow. He was a farmer, and I grew up with his son. And like so many people, he never carved again. And he did about a dozen carvings, and they were all really exquisite. And I don't think he ever realized that he had that talent. If he did, he didn't display it. His son said he never saw these things displayed in their house after the war. But he did them in camp, and this one is really special. Okay. This man was charged with picking up firewood in Poston, I believe. And he would go out into the desert, and he would look for interesting shapes. And this branch he carved into a snake. Next slide. This was made by my grandfather. It's the front of it looks okay. The back is not very elephant-like, but it's charming. Okay, next one. These were drawn by or watercolored by a 15-year-old boy. He painted these on the back of the evacuation notice. And someone tracked him down and said, why did you do this on the back of an evacuation notice? Were you trying to make some political statement? And he said, no, paper was just really hard to come by. And that's what I discovered when I start seeing some of the paintings, some great paintings, but they were done on the back of cereal boxes and things. And, you know, so people had to use whatever material they could get to do it. Okay, next one. This was Santa Fe was a Justice Department INS camp. And when this man was being released to join his family in a regular camp, his fellow prisoners signed their name on a handkerchief and drew the scene of the Santa Fe and gave it to him. Okay. This is the very famous shooting of Mr. Wakase in Topaz. He apparently was chasing a dog or a coyote or something, and he got too near to the fence, and the guard yelled halt. He couldn't hear him, and he was shot and killed. And when that happened, that was after that, the head of the camp ordered all the guards to come before him, and he said to them, and because he realized that these people weren't trying to escape, they were just there. And he said to the guards, you could keep your guns, but you have to give me all your bullets. And at that point, he allowed the fence to be open and people could wander out into the desert. And when the slate quarry where that inkwell was carved from was outside of the fence. So when I talked to Jane Beckwith, she said, I know exactly when he started carving. It was when the slate quarry was open. Okay, next slide. I know I have to hurry this along. This is another, it was hot in the summer, cold in the winter, and there are coal piles. You see a pile of coal there. My aunt said that her father used to stop, wander over to the coal pile and sneak a couple of coal lumps into his pocket so that they would have a little bit more heat at night. Okay. There were all these poetry writing classes and they would make these scrolls. I don't know what they're called. I know they have a formal name. They would write the poem. At the bottom, you see the barracks. And what's interesting was so many of the poetry poems were written by men. Okay, next. So this is what you see here is Arkansas. And the garden in the front was where my parents lived. My mother and my older brother and sister lived there. During the 3.5 years that they were incarcerated, people tried to beautify their surroundings. They tried to make their lives as normal as they could. And, you know, it's amazing. They put on little porches. You know, if you can imagine, these were all barracks and how they built this out. Of course, Arkansas was humid and it rained, so they had vegetation. But you saw some desert scenes in Idaho, and you know, people would cart rocks there to make themselves a rock garden. It was, this was my parents' home. Next slide. I don't know whether this was in Poston or where, but this was definitely the desert. And what's amazing about it is this person built an entire miniature harbor scene. And this harbor scene, if you look at it, there's a lighthouse, there's a bridge, there's even a flag. And someone said to me, you know, where did they get the water? And he said, they cheated because you could see the laundry hanging outside the washroom, the laundry room over there. And so he was able to get water to his harbor scene. And then they had agricultural shows. Okay. In 1944, the government announced that they were going to close the camps and they would give people $25 and a ticket home, train ticket home. And with the exception of Tule Lake and some of the INS camps, all the camps were closed in 1945. And this is a scene of people packing to go home. And that's it. Thank you. Elvin, do you need to say something? Am I on mute? Unmute. Thank you.
So, Alvin, we'll transition to the film clips.
Did I use up all my time? Can I say one more thing?
Actually, I'm sorry. I think we're going to have to just transition to
the
film clip.
Okay. Nobody complains about it.
I got to perform in camp because I knew something about Japanese dancing. I taught the border. Yeah, that was fun. All the blacks sent in the representatives in the recreation hall, and I taught the representatives. And they went back to their blocks, and they taught. Obon, big circle. Not thousands, but, you know, a whole lot. So they all participated in the dance.
It's a wonderful thing to have music in the house. It lifts the spirit, and even for a short moment, you are thinking of nothing but the pureness of that music, regardless of what kind of music it is. And my father had taken the shakuhachi because it was small. And he eventually got a job as a night watchman at the reservoir. And this is to keep people with funny ideas for dropping things into it. And so, you know, he'd have a 24-hour or 36-hour shift. And he took a shakuhachi there. And luckily, the man that also got the job with him was interested in shakuhachi. So my father gave him lessons there. And the two would practice and play. And I think that was the most wonderful thing for my father, who was really very seriously depressed about the situation at hand that he could do nothing about. You know, when you have a passion for life, it's the same with passion for music. And that's the passion that transcends everything. And no matter how sad you might be, that it just erases it all. And for that moment, you're totally in that different world. Each tone is part of your heart. And you just keep playing because the heart is happy. And it resonates throughout your body.
My mother played the three-string instrument shamisen. And when she was interned in Gila River, there was a great shamisen teacher by the name of Jorokusho. My mother was very lucky to become her student.
Some people wanted to learn, you know, and so I start teaching for the children. Mm-hmm. they had all the time, so they used to come, and then we're just like friends, you know, one family. I was the big teacher, and I had whole school, and then everybody came to, we eat together, and it was so much fun.
Oh, I think there were only three of us playing the shamisen. So she had about three to four other students, which is undead, but they didn't perform, mostly girls. Yeah, very seldom. Boys are too interested in basketball and baseball. To me, she was a typical Japanese teacher, no monkey business, you know. You're there to learn well. And she wasn't mean or anything like that, but as I say, we didn't question her. We just went along with it. And the reason was we were afraid of her, you know. She never was mean to us, or she never yelled at us. I guess we were good students. But, you know, that's the way it was.
I play jazz koto in the Murasaki Ensemble and was surprised to learn that our drummer, Vince Delgado, took shamisen and koto from Haruko Suwada in San Francisco in the 1950s, the same teacher my mom had at Topaz Camp.
I think she was in her 60s when we met her. She was pretty small, beautiful, mellow, gracious person, never ill at ease about anything. If you're learning a classical music and with an old tradition, there's no questions to ask. You know, you're just going to be part of that tradition. So you just learn it. You don't have to talk. You keep doing it till you exactly how she wants it. If she plays it again, that means that you haven't done it the way that she wants. And so then you just keep at it. Just do what she said. Then you can leave. But you learn what you can take. And if you can't take any more after a half hour or whatever it was, I don't even remember, then you left. You could leave. You know, it didn't matter whether it was a student waiting or not. Then I was done. But pretty soon, after you've been playing for about a year, you're taking in some big pieces. You know, we were playing like Yu Gao and Midori and Rokudan, and learning by rote helped a lot too, you know, because you didn't have to read the music and memorize it, the music, internalize it that way. You had to internalize it right away. That connected with me with the idea of Zen and being one with whatever you do.
Alvin, you're on mute.
So that was a little clip from Hidden Legacy, which is a project that Shirley Muramoto Wong was involved with. Shirley, did you want to say something about it?
Let's see. Yeah, thank you, Alvin. And thanks for sharing that little clip. Hidden Legacy, I'm not a filmmaker by my background. It was a story that I kind of fell into because my mother learned the koto in camp. And so it led me on this journey to find out how she was able to do that. You know, the narrative is that they could take only what they could carry. When I asked my mom about, you know, how she learned in camp, at first I thought it was summer camp because I was little, and then when I was reading about the history that they could take only what they could carry, the koto is a 6-foot long instrument, and I said, you didn't take that to camp, did you? Right, you know, when you could only take what you could you know, bring with you. So I had all these questions, and I have a feeling she didn't know all the answers either at that time. So it just led me on this long journey to find people who had the same experience in the camps, right? So that's how Hidden Legacy came about. It was something I was very passionate about, just something that was this kind of, you know, driving question in my in my system. I couldn't let it go. And so it took many, many decades to kind of find out the information. And I think it's partially because, you know, the narrative in the camps were, you know, everybody was put there because they were Japanese. They were, the Japanese things were taken away. You know, they were actually even destroyed them before they went to camp. So then everybody thought they needed to be not Japanese as much as possible. So, you know, there's a, in the face of the anti-Japanese, Japanese-American sentiment, and also the drive to assimilate, it was kind of amazing that these people kept up the traditional arts in the camps, to my thinking. I just realized that this film came out in 2014. We were gathering some of these interviews a couple of years before, and everyone that was on that clip, except for Vince Delgado, has passed on. So I'm really glad that we were able to capture their stories told by themselves. I thought it was the best thing to do would be to have them tell their stories themselves, because there is a way and a feeling that comes across from people who experienced it themselves, that I thought was more illustrative of, and you could get the feeling how they felt about doing these things when they were in camp.
How long did it take you I'm interested in, number one, that you didn't focus it solely on the Koto, did it take you a long time? Were you surprised by anything that you discovered and about what was done in camp and the extent of the performances and things? What was surprising to you?
I think that was most surprising to me was how they were able to do it. I mean, you know, like I said, the koto is a 6-foot long instrument. So one of my mm-hmm. questions was, I did focus on the koto first mm-hmm. because I thought that would be the easiest. Mm-hmm. And, you know, how did they play the koto in mm-hmm. camp? So I did find out that some people, you know, they had to bring what they, you know, the main necessities first, right? And sometimes people, friends and whatever, would keep it. And when they ended up at a certain place, the friends would send it to them. But there is a case at Manzanar, Kayoko Wakita said that a man made a koto for his wife at Manzanar. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you were mentioning how there was a lot of wood mm-hmm. around these places. And so they made a lot of things of wood. And this person made the koto out of wood. She said it wasn't like a, you know, a great koto, but she was able to use it to practice on. Mm-hmm. Even my grandfather, my mom's family was at Topaz, but then they moved to Tule Lake. And at Tule Lake, she was able to get a koto with no strings and no bridges, no tuning bridges. So my grandfather made strings from raffia tied end to end for 6 feet, mm-hmm. and also carved the tuning bridges himself and used toothbrush handles for the top piece to hold the strings in. You know, you probably know that arts and crafts materials that they had were mostly wood and toothbrush handles, right? So, you know, he was just using what was there, mm-hmm. but being very creative with it.
How did they get their costumes? When I look at even the odori, you know, where did they get the kimonos? Did they bring it in? Were they sent in? How did they get
a little of all of that? My grandmother brought her wedding kimono with her. Hmm. And a woman who did classical dancing who did not bring her kimono because they're very heavy, right? Hmm. To bring with you. A lot of people, if they brought one, they brought one, right? Mm-hmm. And so she asked my grandmother if she could borrow her kimono. Mm-hmm. Some people brought it in. Some people ordered fabric from Montgomery Ward catalog, Sears catalog, and made it themselves by mm-hmm. hand, right? And I think, like I was mentioning before, some people, you know, friends were able to send it in later, you know, things like that. So, but I noticed in some of the photos, like Obon photos, of people who dressed up in the kimono for the Obon dancing, you know, a lot of those kimonos were the very fancy furisode long sleeves, right? And you know, usually for Obon, which is a summer festival where you wear cotton kimonos, you don't wear such a fancy kimono to an Obon. But that was the one place where they could wear it. That was the one place that they could, you know, express themselves in kimono. So a lot of these Obon photos from the camps, you might see the, a lot of really fancy kimonos being worn at that time, because that's all they had, right?
So were they teaching the musical instruments like the koto? Was somebody teaching them in camp? How did, I mean, was did they expand their interest in music through classes? I know the doll making, there was one woman who was good at it and she taught it. How did they learn?
There were some teachers in the camps. I mean, you know, also the people who taught dance or music or whatever were not all teachers, right? Some of them were just good at what they did and they enjoyed doing it. And someone would even say, oh, I know you're a good dancer. Can you teach the kids? You know, that kind of thing. And, you know, they weren't all like professional teachers, right? Like Yuki Harada from Amachi, she's a student of Fujima Kansuma, but she was a really good student. And she taught the little kids at Amachi, but then she taught them everything she knew. So she asked for a pass to leave the camp to go see Fujima Kansuma at Rower and learn some new dances, which I thought was really interesting. She was about 19 or 20 years old. They gave her a pass to go on a train all by herself to Arkansas and be there for 6 months. learning, learning dance. And then she went back to Amachi and taught kids there.
Interesting.
And
they didn't supervise her. She didn't have to report to any authorities or anything.
I just thought, in my, you know, kind of sansei yonsei brain, I was thinking, gosh, if someone gave me a pass to get on a train, I would just be hightailing it out of there and never come back, right? She did the thing, right, going to another camp and then coming back.
Was there any kind of objection on the part of the camp administrators that so much of the Japanese arts were practiced at camp? I mean, the judo they were doing, you know, was there anything there like, you know, you guys are acting like the so-called enemy?
There was an edict that was put out in September of that year, 1942, I guess, where they said the government would not support any activities that were, you know, Japanese, basically. But we were, you know, I actually did not, was not able to interview any Issei's by the time I got to this project. But we uncovered these letters from an Issei shakuhachi, you know, bamboo flute teacher. And he held a recital the following month after that edict was put out at Manzanar. And, you know, classical recital, and it had a letter from the camp director and the high school music teacher saying they really enjoyed it. They didn't understand it all, but they thought it was a very nice program. And I think what happened was that later on, the WRA realized that if they didn't let people express themselves through the arts, you know, music, dance, drawing, whatever, that, you know, there would be unrest and rioting. I mean, actually, you know, I was thinking all of this expression and creativity and was needed in the camps, not only for to quell unrest, but to also give people something to do, help their mental health, right? Because in a way, it's sort of a parallel to what we just went through with the pandemic, mm-hmm. when people were sort of confined to their homes mm-hmm. and started making bread and learning languages. And, you know, mm-hmm. I actually got new students. Yeah. I never thought I would teach by Zoom, but there you go, right? I mean,
here we are.
Here we are, right? So, you know, but we got to experience what it was like to kind of mm-hmm. try to keep your head mm-hmm. while things were happening. So mm-hmm. I think it's sort of the same idea mm-hmm. what people in the camps were going through, trying to kind of keep their minds stable and, you know, keep mm-hmm. doing something, learning something. Right.
Were most of the people who were doing the Japanese arts Issei? How did that, or, you know, I see the children who were dancing and things, but was this all originate? Was your mother an Issei or a Nisei?
Actually, my mother's Sansei, but.
Your mother's a Sansei?
Yeah, I'm an old Yonsei on my mother's side. I'm actually, my dad's Kibe Nisei, so I'm Sansei on his side, but and she was only about 10 years old. When she went into camp, mm-hmm. right? And a lot of parents did see this as an opportunity to have their children exposed to some of the culture. Uh-huh. Because before camp, it was, you know, if you wanted to learn Japanese koto or dance or whatever, it was a very expensive undertaking. Mm-hmm. But, you know, at camp, no one had money, right? Mm-hmm. So they were all on a level playing field in a way. If they taught, they did it usually for free, or very little money. Mm-hmm. But Bando Mitsusa, who was a teacher at Tule Lake, was paid by the WRA as a mm-hmm. necessary laborer. Mm-hmm. Got paid actually the same amount a Japanese American doctor got paid, $19 mm-hmm. a month. Wow. So she had her own barracks, her own studio, taught mm-hmm. 140 some odd students at Tule wow. Lake.
I wonder how he pulled that off. That's quite a feat.
Well, if you, I don't know if this got in the film, but she said dance was her life. Mm-hmm. That was her mm-hmm. motto. Dance yeah. is my life. And yes. dance was her life. After the camp, she continued to dance and teach in the Los Angeles area. So you might know her down there, right?
So did any of these people go on to, after they left camp, apply their skill teaching or becoming performers in that they are? I know that there are artists, including Ruth Ozawa, who said she learned how to draw in camp. Uh-huh. And it, but are there, were there any performers that you're aware of who got their start in camp?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, most of who I know that continued to do like odori mm-hmm. after camp were mm-hmm. already natoris, you know, mm-hmm. they already were professional, yeah. basically. The only person I know that continued is my mom.
You have a performance coming up. Don't you doing something soon?
I'm producing another virtual event next Thursday, March 3rd, mm-hmm. that's going to highlight the life of Sahomi Tachibana, who taught odori at Topaz and Tule Lake.
Mm. And can anybody see it?
Yeah, everybody can see it. It's free. I think right now you have to register on Eventbrite. Mm-hmm. So you can go on the nextgenjca.com website. That's mm-hmm. Next Gen Japanese Cultural Arts website and mm-hmm. register or go on Eventbrite. Right? Mm-hmm. So she's actually donating a lot of the props that she used for her dancing to mm-hmm. the Topaz Museum. So we're going to show them before her daughter brings them over there. So
that was the other thing I noticed. There are some amazing backdrops to these I mean, who did that and where did they get it?
Right. You know, the ones that we put little film clips of from Tule Lake were by a gentleman named Enjiro Kodani. He was someone who did kabuki arts in Japan, and he used gunny sacks, actually. He sewed gunny sacks together and painted beautiful backdrops. Some of those are in the film. Mm-hmm. And they were just absolutely amazing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there was another kabuki artist who made the wigs, right? Mm-hmm. Gosh, I can't remember his name right now, but he used rope, combed it out to make hair, and colored it black with black shinola polish.
Yeah.
And we had one left from Amachi, that is quite amazing. He used stovepipe for the base of the wig and made some for Bando Mitsusa and also for Yuki Harada, Okobo Harada at Amachi.
Mm-hmm. Great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. That was really fascinating.
Oh, thank you, Delphine. And thank you to everybody who put this on. Thank you, Gardena Valley Japanese Cultural Institute.
Well, now we're going to flip over to something that's totally opposite, the big band sounds. Amy, do you have a clip that you want to show before that?
I think there is a clip.
Some of the most interesting experiences that we had were going outside of camp. The band was hired to play in many of the small towns in Wyoming because they didn't have a big band.
I think it was the summer of 1942, we were invited to play a high school prom over at Thermopolis, Wyoming, which is about 150 miles from where we were. But they sent a bus up, we played the gig. So word got around, I suppose, and we played war bond drives, Elks Lodge dinners, and whatever.
Oh, we ain't got a barrel of money. Maybe we're ragged and funny, but we travel along, singing a song. Oh, you get it, ain't no what coming tomorrow. No what's coming tomorrow. Sharing a road through what kind of weather, what if the sky should fall, just as long as we're together, it doesn't matter at all. When they all had a quarrel and harder, we'll be
And as soon as we performed and the job was over, they took us right back to our confined barbed wire fences.
Mm-hmm. Being kids, you know, we were still teenagers, most of us. It was just another gig, right? And the idea that we could go out, get out of the camp, and get into a real town, was a treat, really, because we could go out and buy candy, things that we didn't have in camp. In fact, we used to sneak in whiskey, which was taboo. And of course, the guards at the gate would come on the bus to search for contraband, I suppose. but eh. We got these bottles of whiskey stashed in our instrument cases and whatever. They never found it. For us, it was a thrill to think that people wanted us to play for them. That's the most thrilling thing that you could, even now, rehearsal's fine, but if you don't perform now and then, and people applaud you, that's the greatest. Better than any kind of money. Something money can't buy.
It improved our self-esteem, I'm talking about musicians, our self-esteem, because the audience, for many of them, most of them, they never saw a Japanese-American group up there playing music that they loved. They thought, wow, I think they must have felt that. So that raised our self-esteem too.
It gave us a feeling of worth to be able to play in this musical group.
The opportunity to play music also put me in with a group of people that I couldn't find any better. And so it put me in with a good crowd that appreciated not only music, but got along.
It's a door opener. Wherever you go, musicians like to have other musicians around them.
Musicians as a whole, they don't care whether you're pink, orange, black, white, or what. Can you play the instrument or can you sing? You're in if you can.
I loved it. I loved the music. I loved the atmosphere, the camaraderie with the musicians. That was my whole life.
It's like a dream come true, And I know it could never have happened outside of camp. I mean, if I had still been living in Los Angeles, first of all, my parents wouldn't have allowed me to go in singing in nightclubs there.
You know, when you're younger and you need the money, you're out playing gigs and whatnot for the money, but when you get older, you just play because you enjoy playing. Yeah. You don't care if they pay you or not. If they pay you, fine.
It was a little natural evolution, I suppose, in terms of my being who I am today. One step led to another, and it started, the impetus started in camp when we did have, for the first time, a dance band. I guess that's what it was. It's continued on and on and on. Swing music, dance music, jazz is my passion. And it stayed with me all these years in my old age.
Okay, so that was a clip from Searchlight Serenade. And if you notice the animation in there, that's the work of Amy Uyeki. Amy, want to say a few things about us?
First off, I want to thank you all at Gardena Valley Japanese Cultural Institute for inviting me. And I think Hideki Obayashi was the person who made contact with me. So I feel honored to be here with Delphine and Shirley. And I'm really impressed by both of your work and research that you've done into the subject matter of art in the camps and how it's a tool of survival and also really a chance for expression and going beyond your circumstance. And the clip was a nostalgic visit for me because many of those people have now since passed that I felt very close to. I met them through this project, the former musicians, and as some of the primary people that I became close to, George Yoshida, Yone Fukui, they have since passed. But there are some of the musicians who are still living today. In fact, I wanted to share, I don't know that this is hard to see in this weird image, but that's Chickie White, who was one of the speakers, sent me a Christmas card. I also heard from Joy Takeshita Teraoka. She was the other female singer. And this is Roy Hatamiya. You can see with his family, I get a Christmas card from him every year. And there, some of these former musicians are still, they're using technology and communicating by email, which is wonderful. So I've been able to stay in contact with those who are still around, but I feel particularly blessed to have been able to meet with these people and to hear their stories, their really joyous stories before, and give them a chance to share those before they did pass. I know that many of the band leaders were older, and I think to a person there was not one that was still living when we started this project in 2010. So I feel lucky that we did. It was timely that we did the filming and interviewing when we did, and I was glad that we were able to interview more than 10 musicians.
Now, you're an artist. How did you get into the big band sound?
That is interesting, because I think there's always the appreciation of, you know, from one art form to the other. I think if you work in, you know, some form of creativity, there's an appreciation for someone who works in another medium. Mm-hmm. And I've always really loved music. I think what was interesting to me, and I think this was also because my parents, having been in the camps and having seen photos, you know, of the dresses, the kinds of clothes they wore, the bobby socks and the saddle shoes and the hair and the, you know, they were really American kids, and they had those American traditions. And I initially, when I started this project, I was thinking of the more recent immigrants, the Lao and the Hmong, and how some of the teenagers were really, you know, they had their own hip-hop culture, their own rap culture, and the sort of uniforms that they wore were, you know, of the rap and hip-hop culture. It was very American. And so there's that transition that happens with probably some people say first generation Americans, but for us, it's the Nisei, the second generation, where I don't think there's so much a rejection, but it's embrace of what they see as their own culture. So that's what intrigued me in the first place, that here is a place that people were, you know, forced to to evacuate and to live because of their racial background, but yet they embraced American culture so much, it was theirs. So, and found in it a release from the drudgery of their existence. And that's what I wanted to bring out to people, because I think that, you know, a lot of people had seen different aspects of the incarceration, but they didn't know that, you know, there was this big band craze, and so many people were, you know, so many teenagers were, that's what they remember the most.
Did you know that you were going to merge the art, your illustrations with the, because it works, it just, but you know, I when I saw it, I thought, did you go into thinking I could bring my artistic style to this, or how did you do it?
That's an interesting question, because I hadn't really thought of that. I think initially I had, first I got to read George Yoshida's book. A friend had told me about him when I expressed an interest in the, you know, that they did big bad music in the camps. And so I saw his book and it became this Bible for me. It was really, really so rich in the irony of these, you know, kids playing this American music behind barbed wire. And then, you know, in Yoni Fukui's case, where in Heart Mountain, the GI band went outside of the camps and performed, and they raised money for war bonds, and then they had to go back into the camps after that. And the irony was so great. I just felt like the story had to be told. And I do use my artwork to tell stories. And I've always been like that. I think I was attracted in early years to artists like Ben Shahn and social realism school. And I tend to use it as a tool to make a point, I guess, or to expose, to share a point of view. And so I was just learning animation. And as you can see, this is not Pixar at all. It's very simple,
but it's charming.
Well, it's very rough, but I thought, you know, because we don't, I mean, there were some clips of that time period that are available through the National Archives. Mm-hmm. I sort of wanted to tell a full story of, you know, being the actual animation in itself is a 15-minute story that follows the, you know, the whole Pearl Harbor, and then being the 9066, and following a couple of people in their immersion into being part of the band, and sort of follows the story of the Heart Mountain group, the GI band. So anyway, it originally started as an animation, and then I had a friend who worked at a local PBS station, and she was the one who brought in, let's bring in the interviews, let's find people, which turned out to be, you know, really, like Shirley was saying, having people tell their stories is so important and so mm-hmm. poignant, and they can share things that really their memories, mm-hmm. that's one thing that they really kept, that they were able to share. So that was really important. Mm-hmm. Finding them was another challenge. So, you know, we were very lucky to get as many as we did, and we had a lot of dead ends in that. I would follow, you know, contact people and get to the final place, and then we found out they passed or they were unable to talk with us. And so
did it was. Oops, sorry.
No, go ahead.
Did any of them pursue music careers after they got out of camp?
I think that some of the band leaders did, but I think in contrast to, you know, I think the remarkable artwork that you discovered, and to me it was a shock that those people didn't continue to do that artwork. Probably they were too busy raising families and, mm-hmm. and working that they couldn't mm-hmm. do that. But a lot of these musicians continued to play, maybe on a, well, certainly on a recreational basis, mm-hmm. and some professionally as well. Mm-hmm. And they, like George Yoshida, you know, continued to play with different people. And Yone Fukui, who was in the GI band, he was playing when we met, he was playing four nights a week or something like that with all these different groups, a German band group and the Elks Club and Japanese American jazz band that played together too. So I would say at least half of them were continuing. The two singers also sang, you know, locally, I think Joy Taraoka is still singing in the residence that where she lives.
Mm-hmm. I was impressed with all the historical footage you got. Was that strictly from the National Archives, or did you get it someplace else? Because you had a lot.
Oh, some of it, I'd say most of it was from the National Archives. And we got a lot of personal photos from mm-hmm. different musicians. So that helped a lot. We were probably mining the same sources. Mm-hmm. and it's amazing how much footage there is. You know, once you do a search in a particular subject matter, like I also was amazed at, you know, the images that you came up with, Delphine, because they were not ones I was seeing, but maybe it was related to the search mm-hmm. that you did. And it has become a lot easier with the internet. And I think George Yoshida, it just makes me so impressed with how much research he did to interview all these people, because it was not done, you know, with the internet at all. It was probably just through contacts. And I think he had a huge file box of all his contacts. And so he was able to share some of those names with me of different people. And then I went on from there.
Well, when I saw the footage, I thought, where did she get that? You know, I never saw that one. Looks good.
I was thinking the same thing of your work. So I guess that just shows you what is out there. It's
really.
The WRA, that was one benefit for having, you know, all these photographers out there, is mm-hmm. they did take mm-hmm. a lot of footage. And mm-hmm. and then there were you know, personal images mm-hmm. that people started, as you said, when they started to be able to have cameras in the camps.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, to change the subject, you did a book on the tsunami, I guess the boat that ended up in California. Do you always tackle Japanese subjects? You've traveled extensively. I was wondering, do you have sort of an affinity to these subjects?
I think a couple of reasons. This is, for people not familiar, this is a boat. It was actually named Kamome, which is mm-hmm. Means seagull or gull. Mm-hmm. And during the Japanese tsunami, it belonged to a high school. It was a training boat, and it floated across the ocean. It mm-hmm. took 2 years to mm. get from the shores of Japan to Northern California was, it came to rest in a county that's north of us, Del Norte. So my connection there is probably with the researcher, the tsunami expert, who's a professor at our Humboldt State, call it Cal Poly Humboldt now. And she was a person who got me involved, but I think the friendship that happened because of the students on in Del Norte cleaning up the boat and with a lot of help getting it sent back to the high school and the cultural exchange and friendships that have has come about with these two towns that are very similar in you know, economic makeup, and they're not, you know, big tourist towns. They're fishing, you know, have a fishing history. They both have, you know, sort of tsunami connections, and that Crescent City's been hit by a tsunami. There were a lot of connections there. So the story really interested me. I just think also when something has traveled that far and long, it is like a character in itself. It has its own story, and it had all these creatures growing from it that, you know, it was sort of its own little bio system.
I want to see the book. I haven't seen it. I want to get a copy. But what's your next project? What are you working on now?
Well, I have a couple of projects. One, I'm working, I've done some animation for, there are, I think, four films that are being made out of, about a Mad River Wiyot artist named Rick Bartow, who has since passed, but he was an amazing artist. He worked mainly in Oregon, and I was asked to bring his paintings to life in a way. So as part of one of the films. So that's coming out in April. And I've also just revived. I've been working on this project with a composer from, she was from the Berkeley area. She's moving to Santa Fe, but it's about women composers. So I'm really excited about that. I have about 4 minutes of animation for that. And we're gonna pick that up again. I've had a lot of detours on the way, and actually the Kamo May project keeps on having different aspects of it. We've made it into an animation. It's been translated into Chinese and German and French and Russian and native Talawa language, Vietnamese, Swedish. So that has a lot of different iterations and keeps on going.
Well, here's my last question. These were woodcuts? And could you explain that to me? How did you, I mean, I was looking at it and you said woodcuts, and I was looking at.
That's a good question, because you're probably saying those don't look like woodcuts, but they started out as woodcuts. And I think, you know, as a newcomer to animation, the whole idea was I wanted something to look, you know, like, woodcuts are a part of the Japanese cultural tradition. So they started out as woodcuts, and I printed them, and then I transferred them to, you know, they were just black and white. But then because they were black and white, I wanted a lot more nuance. So I wanted all these shades of gray. So basically I almost had to redraw every woodcut, because I'd have to pull out the figure. I'd have to put in, you know, different shades of gray, and then take apart bodies and you know, put them back into, or put them into an environment, and then where it was, there would be a big hole. So I'd have to fill in with other lines to make that. It was a lot of work, and probably I couldn't.
Did you do a lot of that manipulation on the computer?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. It was done on the computer. Once I had the woodcut images, then all that playing around had to be done on the computer.
Okay.
So I made more work for myself than I needed to, but it was a good process.
I kept studying it, thinking, how did she do that?
So some of them have more computer manipulation than the, I think some of the earlier scenes are where there's less animation, there's more woodcut. When the scenes with a lot of musicians, that's a lot of computer.
Well, I think I'm supposed to turn this back to people who have questions for us. Is it Elvin, are you taking over?
Yes, thank you, Duffy.
Thank you.
So actually the first question I have is for you. Someone noticed that on the drawings that you showed that there was a red honko seal with the name of the artist in the corner. And they wanted to know if you know anything about whether families brought their honkos into the camps, or did they make them into camps? Do you know anything about that? Delphine?
It's for me?
Yes.
Oh. No, I mean, what were they talking about?
The honkos. I don't know which painting that was, like, or drawing.
Yeah, my,
they showed one and it appeared to have a honko seal. Somebody noticed.
I think they did. I mean, I noticed that several artwork had the, you know, the stamp thing, like this one here. This was Obata, and I think he always stamped his. So that's probably true there. This one didn't. What's interesting is so many of these people did not pursue their work afterwards. Obata certainly did, but. You know, when you hear of the artist, you don't, you know, I had known some of them, but I knew them as farmers. I didn't know them. I didn't know they had that kind of talent. It was just, you know, I'd sit there when they first started coming in, when I was borrowing them to photograph them for the book, I would sort of look at them on my coffee table and think, could I have done that? And I, you know, and also because I knew some of the people, it's like, he did that. I don't know. I mean, I realized that I didn't give people credit for, you know, what they could pull out of themselves. And in some ways, I think they didn't give themselves credit either, because when they got out of camp, they didn't try to pursue it again. They, you know, they really thought, you know, everybody in camp was doing some kind of artwork. Mine isn't so special. And one man said, there was a boat that's in my book. And he said that when the camps closed, it was such a big boat, he couldn't take it home. You know, he was just given $25 in train fare home, and they didn't know where they were going to live. So he was just going to throw it away at the camp. And I think a fair number of people did that, because I know that in Arkansas, one person went through the barracks and picked up things that were thrown away that were made by people in camp. Because they really just saw their stuff as make do work. And what's remarkable is that they, and in some ways, I think that one of the reasons they could
be so creative is because they didn't come into it with all these expectations that they were fine artists. You know, they let themselves go, they did it. And in many ways, I think that's what gave them the creative freedom to invent things. So I didn't answer your question, but yeah, there were some echoes in there.
Okay. Shirley, there's a question. Could you talk a little more about your mom learning Koto in the camp and how that experience may have helped her endure the life there?
Unmute this?
Yeah.
Well, you know, she was only about 10 years old when she started learning Koto in camp. And it was on the insistence of my grandmother. My grandmother loved Koto music. So, you know, this was kind of to expose her to the music, but I'm not really sure if it... I mean, I feel like any activity that people did in the camp was to help them, you know, persevere somehow, right? I mean, she had an interesting experience, you know, when my grandparents gave up their citizenship. They moved to Japan after the war. And so she continued to learn Koto in Japan. But she had an experience with a teacher there. You know, I don't know if people know this, but after the war, Japan was quite devastated. It was, you know, not only the Hiroshima bombing, but there was bombing all over the country. And there was going to be a program at New Year's. A lot of times traditional groups get together for the New Year's celebration and they put on kimonos and things like that. So she said, she went to her sensei and said, do I need to look for a kimono? Because it was difficult to get one at that time. And so the sensei said, no, you don't have to wear a kimono. But when she came to the event, everyone was in a kimono except for her. So she actually experienced, you know, some prejudice there because her teacher introduced her as her American student. Right. So I thought, well, that might be a real psychological blow to you when you're you know, you face this in America and then you go to Japan, you face it in Japan. Right. So, you know, but, I think she did go through a lot of psychological sort of, you know, things in her head because she didn't feel accepted anywhere because of this. But she went to another Koto school after that, and they took her in, and it was like a big family, and she finally felt like she belonged somewhere. And so she, you know, she got her teaching degree from there and was very, you know, and still is very loyal to the school, right? Because she kind of found a family there, you know, some place to belong. So, does that answer the question? I don't know.
Yes. So, a question about the big bands. How did the people, when they performed outside the camp, what was the reaction from the people on the outside?
I think that they loved having them there. I think primarily it was in Wyoming, at Heart Mountain, where the band was able to go outside of the camps. And I think because, I don't know, if, you know, because of the war and maybe other bands were broken up because there are young people who, you know, were enlisted or whatever. There wasn't live music anywhere in these small towns or where Heart Mountain was, Lowell and Powell, and, you know, they're very small towns. So when they heard there was this great band in the camps that they probably heard from, you know, the people working in there, that's when they thought that this was, you know, this would be a good thing. And so they played for proms and, you know, big social events and any time when they wanted live music, they were, you know, hired to perform. And there were several of the musicians who were in that camp talked about what it was like to go out and, you know, have this freedom and then have to take that bus back, you know, behind barbed wires but it was exciting for them, as Yone talked about it in the film.
Okay, well, I think that's all the time we've got. So thank you, Delphine Hirasuna, Shirley Muramoto Wong, and Amy Uyeki. Thank you for joining us today. There's so much more to learn about all the topics that we've covered. If you go to the JCI website, there's more. You could see the full films that Shirley and Amy have worked on, and Delphine has her books on the Art of Gaman and All That Remains. So there's so much more to that everyone can learn about this if they're interested. We've got a brief recorded message from Holly Mitchell, who represents the Los Angeles County Board of Supervisors 2nd District.
Hello, I'm Supervisor Holly Mitchell, Chair of the Los Angeles County Board of Supervisors, and I'm honored to join you for our annual Day of Remembrance. As you well know, Presidential Executive Order 9066 was a gross injustice that resulted in the wrongful incarceration of over 120,000 Americans of Japanese ancestry. This atrocious violation of civil and human rights marks a dark time in our country's history, and the preservation of this history is critical to ensuring that it never happens again. So I proudly stand in solidarity with our Japanese communities across the globe, as well as the thousands of residents of Japanese ancestry who call LA County their home. There is no place for injustice or hate in our community. Getting justice isn't quick or easy. You know, it took 46 years for the federal government to make an official apology and pay $20,000 in reparations to each survivor. And just 10 years ago, the LA County Board of Supervisors finally rescinded a 1942 motion that supported Executive Order 9066. As Maya Angelou says, when we know better, we do better. And so it's important that we continue to uplift these experiences and work to right wrongs for all communities who were victimized by hate and discrimination. Your work in preserving and teaching this history is critical to ensuring we remember the lessons of the past and continue to correct all injustices caused by all forms of enslavement. I thank you.
And our thanks to Holly Mitchell and the LA County Board of Supervisors. I want to do a quick plug for Kyoko Nancy Oda. She's got a new book out, The Tule Lake Stockade Diary. And we had a program here about a month ago. It's about her father's, Tatsuo Ryusei Inoue's, detailed diary that he kept while he was in the stockade at Tule Lake. And for those who aren't familiar, at Tule Lake, there was actually a prison inside the concentration camp. So I would highly recommend people check out her book. So for our past week, we've been posting a lot of information on the GVJCI website as part of our Day of Remembrance programs. As I mentioned earlier, you can see more about the topics we covered today and even additional topics. There's an interview with Atsushi Ishida, who performed comedy skits at Jerome as a member of the Nonkina Boys. And there's a lot of information about arts and crafts that were created. For instance, an artist who was local here, Heishiro Otani, who did woodwork, and his family has generously donated some of his work to the GVJCI. So you can go to our website and read a little bit about him and so many other artists. So, and we're so grateful to all of the groups and people who contributed to all of that material that's on our website. There's a lot there. And even what's there is just the tip of the iceberg on this subject. There are links that send you out to other sites, Janum and Densho, and you can really learn a great deal more about the arts and that were a big part of camp life. So I've got a few announcements. I should also mention the website is, in case you don't know, jci-gardena.org. Okay, so be sure to go and look at all of the material there. A couple announcements. The annual Hinamatsuri Girls Day program is going to take place virtually on Saturday, March 5th from 2 to 4 p.m. So join us for some fun arts and crafts, as well as cooking, as we learn about this Japanese holiday. We'll also have a three-part haiku and tanka writing workshop on Wednesdays, March 16th, 23rd, and 30th from 6 to 7:30 p.m. at the GVJCI. We will be reopening the facilities in March, and that'll be taught by Jeannie Nakano. Now, this, of course, has been a free program, and there's no charge for you to go to the website and to look at all of the materials that we have there. However, if you enjoy this program, we do appreciate donations. And for $20 or more, there is a commemorative pin set gift that you can get. It's just like this one here. There's also another pin with the JCI logo on it. So, yes, as I mentioned, if you enjoy this program and you'd like to see more programs like this, we do encourage you to make at least, you know, contribute what you can. My thanks once again to the George and Sakai Aratani Community Advancement Research Endowment and the UCLA Asian American Studies Center for co-sponsoring. Our thanks once again to Dr. Ina Domi for his support. And to all of our wonderful community supporters, if you go on our website, there are links to the websites of all of these organizations, and I'd encourage you to go and to see all the good work that they are doing. Thanks to our program manager, Stephanie Maeda, and we've got Michelle Hirano in the background, making sure all of this runs smoothly. And thanks to all of the GVJCI Day of Remembrance Planning Committee members. They dedicated a lot of time and energy to help bring this program to you. And if anyone out there would like to volunteer and be part of this committee next year, talk to Stephanie. Our thanks once again to Delphine Hirasuna, Shirley Muramoto Wong, and Amy Uyeki for joining us today. We appreciate them taking time out of their busy lives and participating in this program. And thank you to all of you for watching today. This concludes the program, and I thank you and enjoy the rest of your weekend.